Hello everyone, welcome to my class. This is the first video on microprocessor and interfacing course. Before we start, let me give you some examples of microprocessor. Microprocessor is used as the central processing unit or CPU in a computer. Not only in computers or smartphones, microprocessors is everywhere, like automatic testing of products, speed control of a motor, traffic light control, TV, satellite, home appliances such as washing machine, microwave, or a self-driving car. So we can see microprocessor almost everywhere. So to start with, I will start with evolution of microprocessor. Intel introduced its first 4-bit microprocessor 4004 in the year 1971 and its 8-bit microprocessor 8008 in the year 1972. But these microprocessors were limited by its design and performance. The second generation of microprocessor was introduced in the year 1973. Which was an 8-bit microprocessor 8080 and 8085 in the year 1977, which was with more added features, which worked as a complete microprocessor. But it was again limited by its low speed, low memory addressing capability, and lesser powerful instruction set. Then came the third generation. In the family of 16-bit microprocessor, 8086 was launched in the year 1978 with high speed, high packaging density, easier to program with interrupt handling capabilities and flexible I/O port addressing. But this generation still used a coprocessor for any floating point operation. That means 8086 or 80286, which were the 16-bit processor, were only capable of performing integer operations. They used a coprocessor for any floating point operation. Next came the fourth generation with low power versions of HMOS technology. It was 32-bit processor with having a physical memory of almost 16 megabytes and virtual memory of 1 terabyte. The advantage with this generation was floating point operation. They did not require a coprocessor to do so. And at present, we are with fifth generation, which is your Pentium processor came. And we will majorly in this particular course discuss about the 16-bit processor 8086 or 80286 and some part of your 32-bit processor, which is 80386 and 486. So to understand the operation of a microprocessor, first thing we will look into is the basic blocks in any computing system will include. So the first thing we should have for any computing system is your central processing unit or CPU with some primary memory like ROM or RAM. Along with that, we can have some secondary memory like hard disk drive or external USB disk or optical disk drives. Along with that, we should have some I/O devices like your keyboard, mouse, or display. Now, all these devices are connected to your CPU with the help of a set of buses, which we basically call as your address bus, data bus, and control bus. These are the set of parallel lines called as buses, which connects your microprocessor or CPU with the external world. We will discuss about these different types of buses in little more detail as we proceed. But at this point of time, I will just show that what are the basic blocks we should have or any computing system should have. So how this entire unit actually works. So when you turn on a computer, it starts executing a set of instructions from a predefined memory location. like your OS loads program and execute it, so we can see screen or some of the icons on your PC. So what is this instruction? Basically, instruction is a command given to your computer to perform a specific operation. Like, we can take a data transfer operation or arithmetic or logical operation, read and write operation. Let us take some example to understand what an instruction is and how a microprocessor handles an instruction. So we'll start with a very simple basic example. I have taken here a instruction move AX, BX. What this instruction does? It basically copies the content of your BX register onto the AX register. So let us assume the content of BX register or the data stored in a BX register is A12C in hexadecimal. So after the instruction move AX, BX, the content of the AX will be same as that of the BX. That means now AX will update it to A12CH. So this particular assembly language instruction move AX, BX, move in this case is your opcode. AX and BX are the operands. So when we write this instruction, the assembler generates an equivalent machine code. As we know that our processor can understand only binary numbers. So my assembler converts this assembly language instruction move AX, BX into a equivalent machine code or binary number. So this particular machine code will be stored in the memory. So how this particular instruction is handled by a microprocessor? So to understand that, we will take a little more closer look into the architecture of the microprocessor. So basically, your CPU is divided into two parts. One is bus interface unit, BIU, and the other one is your execution unit. So what the bus interface unit does? The first thing it does is it generates the address from where we need to fetch the instruction. So BIU will generate the address and we will go to that particular, if it is in ROM or RAM, we will go to that particular address in the memory. The control signal will be sent to the external devices to read or write operation. So in this case, the data will be loaded onto the data bus and available to the execution unit. So basically, BIU generates an address, fetches the instruction from memory. It performs read or write operation on the ports, writes data to the port and memory. Yes? Similarly, the execution unit basically contains your control and timing unit, instruction decoding, arithmetic and logical unit. So main function of your execution unit is to generate the control signal using control and timing unit, decode the instruction and then execute the instruction. Yes, so if I look into my CPU in more detail, you can see that your bus interface unit contains program address generator. So what is the function of your program address generator? Basically, it generates the address for fetching the instruction. So once this address is being given to the memory unit or that particular memory location, the instruction is being fetched. Once the instruction is being fetched, it is available in the data bus and instruction comes back to the BIU. The fetched instruction comes back to the BIU and it will be stored in BIU in the instruction register. After the instruction is fetched, now we need to decode the instruction. Yes, so that instruction is decoded within the execution unit. After we decode the instruction, the operands are fetched. Like in the previous example, we wrote move AX, BX. So I have fetched the instruction. So now The equivalent machine code for move AX, BX is available in instruction register. Once it is available in the instruction register, next we decode the instruction. We have to understand what operation we have to do. In this case, we have to perform move operation. Third part is the data or the operands. So I have to know who are the operands upon which we have to perform the operation. So operand fetch is the third operation being done for executing the instruction. So operands are being fetched. In this case, the operands are AX and BX. So let this operand are present in A register and B register. After operands are being fetched, they will be given to execution unit. As I have to perform some move operation, I will copy the data of BX to AX, and then the result will be stored in your AX register. Yes, so any instruction is handled by these basic steps by a microprocessor. The first thing microprocessor does is it fetches the instruction. That means it generates an address. So BIU is basically used to generate the program address. Yes, so it generates the address from where you need to fetch the instruction. Once the instruction is being fetched, that means it is available to my BIU, it is stored within the instruction register. After storing in the instruction register, it is being decoded. The instruction is being decoded. Instruction decode. Then after decoding the instruction, I know what operation I need to do. Now, who are the data or operands? We go for fetching the operands. Now, in this case, I have fetched the operands are A and B. Then we perform the operation on the operands, execution. Yes, once the execution is complete, the result will be stored in the destination. Yes, so this is how any microprocessor will handle an instruction. Hence, based on execution model or processor registers, addresses and data formats, microprocessor can be studied in different various ways. Which we are going to look into is in terms of instruction set architecture. So we will study microprocessor in terms of instruction set architecture, which will basically focus on execution model or processor registers, addresses and data formats. So we will look into what instruction set architecture is basically talks about. Let us take one example here. I have taken an instruction add AX, BX, where this add is called as opcode and AX and BX are the operands. Yes, for this particular assembly language instruction, AX and BX are registers. And as I have already told, whenever we execute this instruction, the assembler first generates the equivalent machine code. Yes, we can see here that the instruction add AX, BX have 16-bit machine code. Whereas, I will take another example where I am writing add BX, M1, where M1 is a memory location. I am adding the content of memory location M1 with that of the BX, and the result will be stored in BX register. Yes, so here for this particular instruction, BX is a register, M1 is a memory location. So when I generate a machine code for this particular instruction, add BX, AX, you can see the size of this machine code. So here you can see the instruction which performs almost similar operation as we have done in the first instruction, but the size of your machine code generated will vary from 16 bit to it is going now to 32 bit, or even further more it can vary. So basic differences, you can see that with the red color, whatever I have shown, this is the equivalent binary representation of your opcode. Yes. So we will look into in detail after a few classes how to generate a machine code. But at this point, my objective is to see if the operands are present within the processor, within the CPU, then the size of your machine code and the instruction which performs similar task, but one of the operand is external to CPU. It is present in a memory location. The size of the machine code varies a lot. Yes. So basically, if the instruction can be present anywhere, that means if my operands are not limited, they can be within the your CPU or they can be in memory location, then the size of my instruction or basically the machine code varies. So when you write add B X comma M1 at the stage after fetching the instruction, the BIU will first fetch the instruction and then we will go for instruction decoding. After instruction decoding, when I am going for fetching the operand, at that time we have to see the operands are internal or not internal to your execution unit or to your CPU. If it is not within the CPU, like it is one of the operand is present in memory location M1, then again I have to take the help of BIU, generate the address of your memory location M1 and fetch the operand. So my instruction becomes complicated or decoding becomes complicated. So based on these aspects, whether my operands are internal to the CPU or operand can reside anywhere, the instruction set architecture is classified into CISC architecture and RISC architecture. Complex instruction set computer or reduced instruction set computer. As the name says, the complex instruction set computer, operands for arithmetic or logical operation can be within the CPU or external to the CPU. It can reside anywhere within the CPU or in memory. Whereas in case of reduced instruction set computer, the operands for any operation can only be within the register. Yes. So in terms of your designing a instruction decoder, RISC is a simpler architecture. Yes, compared to CISC, because here my instruction decoder will be very, very complicated compared to that of the RISC processor. But while writing the program, it becomes easy. We do not have any limitation for our operand. It could be present within the register or outside the CPU. It can be stored in the memory. Your operand could be present anywhere and you can directly write instruction for them. Whereas in case of RISC processor, all the operands should be within the register, within your CPU. That is why it is sometimes called as register architecture. So I'll take just one small example to compare this RISC architecture with that of the CISC architecture. So I have taken a 3 16-bit numbers stored in memory locations M1, M2 and M3. So my objective is to add these three numbers and store the result in memory location M4. Here I have taken this M1, M2, M3 and M4 are the memory locations and we have few registers with name A0, A1, A2, A3 and ALU. Yes, so if I am having a CISC architecture, the instruction could be, here I have taken three operand instructions. So instruction could be add A0, M1, M2. What this instruction will do? It will add the content of M1 with that of the M2 and store the result in A0 register. Yes. Then the next instruction we have written is add M4, A0, M3. So what this instruction will do? It will add A0, which is the sum of M1 and M2 with M3 and store the result in the memory location M4. As it is CISC architecture, my operands can present anywhere within the register or in memory. Whereas if I am going for RISC architecture, it is necessary for me to have all the operands within the register. So what we are doing, first I am loading the data within the register or copying the data onto the register. Load A0, M1. It will copy the content of M1 or it will load the content of M1 onto A0. Second instruction will load the content of M2 on A1, M3 on A2. Now the data, three data M1 which are present in M1, M2, M3 are now copied onto register A0, A1 and A2. Then I am going to add A0 with A1 and store the result in A0. Then I will add A0 with A2 and store the result in A0. Then I will store the content of A0, which is the sum of A0 plus A1 plus A2 onto a memory location M4. So if we compare this to architecture, you can see as a programmer, it is easy for me to write instructions in CISC architecture compared to that of the RISC architecture. But as a designer, my instruction decoding will be more complicated in case of CISC as compared to that of the RISC architecture. Yes. So here you can see the CISC architecture. You can see one instruction can have multiple operations, or we call it as a micro operations. Whereas in case of a RISC architecture, one instruction is one operation. So this is the basic comparison introduction class, a basic computing system with the overview of how a simple computing system looks like, the basic architecture of 8086, and this particular course we are going to take up in terms of its instruction set architecture. Under that we have two broad categories, RISC architecture and CISC architecture. So in the next class onwards, we will again start our discussion with your 86 processor in little more detail and which particular architecture is being followed there. Thank you for watching my video.